Okay, let's not all get so prickly and frosty here. We're all friends. All right, now let's go. We've all vowed a vow and swore an oath. Take out your books and your notebooks. And let's get going. Okay. All right. So let's erase the board here and start fresh. So this chapter, you know, I will say this. This chapter is a little tricky. This chapter is a little tricky in that there's a lot of things going on that you probably have never heard about before and seem strange to you. So you might have been confused in the middle. I'm guessing that's true for some of you. Like, I'm guessing, you know, you guys have maybe never heard of or don't really know what, like, St. Elmo's fire or Corpuscence are. I never heard of these things. If you looked it up, that's awesome. But let me ask you something. How is this different from other parts of the book where something unfamiliar is part of the action?
Oh, usually Ishmael explains it before.
Do you hear this? Yes? Usually Ishmael will take a little moment to explain it. Now, why do you think he didn't do that here? Why do you think he didn't say, like, oh, before we get into this chapter, I want to explain to you this electromagnetic phenomena that happens on board ships in the middle of storms?
So that it adds a little more of a, symbolic
suspect. Finish your own thought.
I mean, it had a little more of, like, a natural, just kind of more supernatural than anything.
Yeah. In other words, that's excellent, Christian. This sort of thing's not common, right? This is not an ordinary part of whaling. So when it happens, we're all sort of like, wow, this is kind of weird. We feel a little off balance, you know. So it's not typical documentary because it's so unusual. And it seems supernatural, like Kristen said. That's excellent. So, you know, I think as a result, it's a little confusing. And I don't blame you if you were confused. Although I do blame you if you didn't do anything about it. Now, let's do this. Let's do 117, very short chapter, Whale Watch. Can you guys open to that? I want to read a little bit of the first opening scene. So, who's feeling like reading right now? Anybody else? No, nothing. That's fine. Luke, are you ready to read?
Of course.
Okay, but you can't read in any kind of wacky way. This is kind of serious, all right?
Sure.
All right, so let me remind you of the scene, okay? Scene opens. Very bizarre. I want to make sure you only hear the language that Luke's going to read, but I want to make sure you understand where we are. Why are we out in the middle of the ocean, far from the Pequot? Go ahead, say it, Margaret.
Didn't someone already say
that? That's not an answer to my question. You're right. There's a dead whale.
Yeah.
They're actually like docked up, right? But what's the issue? Why are they here? Why are they spending the night next to this dead whale? Go, Simi. Simi, no one can hear you.
They, like, the boats killed, like, four whales that night, but, Ahab's boat killed the windward one, and they couldn't really, like, take it back to the Pequot until morning.
Right, so they're just going to have to, like, spend the night, like, tied up to a dead whale. And meanwhile, it's all around them.
Sure.
Right, so picture this. A big, giant corpse next to you, right? Huge, dead whale. And then all around, we've seen this before, right? Sharks kind of feeding on it. And meanwhile, you're trying to sleep in this little tiny wooden boat in the middle of the ocean with no ship, which is your home, anywhere in sight. Strange, right? Go. Now listen carefully. Read nice and loud.
Not seldom in this life when on the right side fortune's favorites fail close by us.
No one can hear a word you're saying. I don't think you're in the right place. Probably really want you to hear.
The wave pole was thrust upward into the dead whale's spout hole, and the lanterns hanging from the top and its top cast a troubled flickering glare upon the black which gently chapped the whale broad's flank like soft surf upon a beach.
Okay, just stop right there. This is kind of, this is a strange place, right? Wouldn't you agree? And it's doubly strange. It's being lit in this weird way. Did anybody bother looking up a wave pole? Did you say yourself, I don't know what a wave pole, so I think I'll go look it up. So a wave pole would be a long pole, which they then would just basically jam into the whale's spout hole. It would have like usually have a big pennant on it. Why?
So you hang away.
So you can like find
a pennant.
Is it like a flag?
It's a flag for
so the ship.
Yeah, so the ship, you know, it's not hard to, it's not easy to see things far out at sea with waves that are 50 feet high, you know what I mean? Like it's hard, it's easy to miss this sort of thing. So a wave pole with a big red flag would allow them to be able to see. Are you with me? But as you see, there's a lamp. So the picture is middle of the night, dark, a lamp, you know, spreading its eerie glow over this already eerie scene. Very dramatic, don't you think, Brendan?
Why wouldn't they just run a rope from the boat to the smaller boat?
Say that again?
Okay.
Wait, say that again.
Why wouldn't they just, like, connect the two boats with a long rope?
What two boats?
The boat that killed the whale and the people out of them.
This rope would have to be 5 miles long.
No, like the Peacock could go to them. Forget it.
No, I want you to understand what you're asking. So look, when they see whales, and they lower and away, right? We've seen this now twice, right? They may chase that whale for a mile or two, right? And they harpoon it, and they go on, the next moment they go on what's called a Nantucket sleigh ride. What do you suppose that means? Yeah, this whale is like hauling you through the surf until what happens? Well, first it just gets
tired.
Really tired, and then we saw Stubb, remember, stab it to death. Now, that may be happening far, far, far away. And meanwhile, if my whale's going a mile or two this way, and your whale's going a mile or two this way, we're 4 miles apart now. It means this is happening over a broad expanse of ocean.
Right.
So there's no rope long enough to be able to tie these boats together, right?
What if the Pequod never found?
Did that almost happen? The first time they lowered, they got lost. Don't you remember?
Yeah.
The Pequod was sailing away. They had no intention. They thought they had forgot them.
Oh, yeah. And then
they ran them over accidentally. Remember this? So this is the dangers of doing this job regularly. You're out in a little boat that's no bigger than this table in the middle of the ocean hoping your buddies are going to find you later on. Yeah.
How do they catch a whale that has these huge fins and can go, I'm assuming, faster than a boat with paddled by man? How do the men, like...
Catch up with it?
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes they don't, but we... I mean, a boat with six guys rowing could go very fast.
Really?
And also, if you remember, I don't know if I told you this or you read it, a sperm whale or whales in general don't just dive right away. They have to get their breath. So they don't just... They're not like you. They can't go and go under. They'll stop, and they'll breathe, and then they'll go, because they're planning on being in there for half an hour, right? So they have these weird habits that they know... whale will follow, and they are able to hunt them. I mean, they did it all the time, right? Okay, now, strange, odd scene. I'm going to read one little more paragraph with you guys. I'm going to read this one. Ahab and all his boat's crew seemed to sleep, but the Parsi, who, crouching in the bow, sat watching the sharks that spectrally played round the whale and tapped the light cedar planks with their tails, a sound like the moaning in squadrons over Asphaltites of unforgiven ghosts of Gomorrah ran shuddering through the air. Okay, now, to make this scene doubly weird, that's an important word, you'll see in a minute. There's a weird sound, right? The wind and the illusion. Do you guys remember Gomorrah or not? Okay, so those two cities are always associated because in the book of Genesis, God destroys those two cities with brimstone from heaven. You with me? So picture this. What do you suppose Gomorrah looked like the day after?
Scorched.
Yeah, this like ghost town torched with like these souls of ghosts sort of like floating around. This is where this scene takes place. Are you following me? This is creepy. Now, let me ask you something. Does this scene remind you of another scene that you may have read one time where a certain person encounters his future? Do you guys read Macbeth?
Yeah.
Yeah. Right? Do you remember when he comes upon those three weird sisters?
Oh, yeah.
Right, the first time. It's actually in a kind of war-torn, strange place like this.
Yeah,
you know?
This
is like in the middle of nowhere. Do you remember this? And
yeah.
Here suddenly they are, right? So I think there's echoes of Macbeth here. Now, let's do this. Basically, the bottom line is this. If someone says to you, I dreamed it again, what does that imply?
That you told them
run away.
No. Pay attention. If I see you in the hallway, Brad, and I say, I dreamed it again.
You've previously talked.
Yeah, we've had this conversation before. You with me? These two have been talking about this thing before. Yes?
Yeah.
Now, the thing that's important about this chapter is for you to get the information. All right. So there are a few prophecies we all need to have in our noggin right now. What are they? Let's list them. So what are the prophecies that may or may not come true? Well, let's just list them. Go.
That Ahab is going to be hung.
Okay, let's put it this way. He's going to die by him. And as you say, he's going to read that as he's going to get hanged. Okay? Next. Let's just get the facts down, Steve. Go ahead, Margo.
Allah is going to die before.
Yeah, but Allah will go first. It's not just that he will go first. He says, and I will pilot you. Do you guys know what a pilot is?
Like,
yeah, it's a guide. Like, usually what would happen, I don't know if you guys know this, but like, when a big ship comes into a port, usually a pilot ship will come first. It's small and knows the port and will guide it in, right? So he's going to be the pilot. All right, what else? There's more.
You'll see two hearses.
Two hearses, okay. Now, I want to make sure we all know what these are. What are hearses?
Hey,
go.
Yeah.
They're those cars that carry like a coffin on the way to the car.
Yeah, so what would this be?
Carriage.
A car?
No, like anything
like this. Yeah, but like what's...
A carriage.
Yeah, a carriage or some kind of cart, right? But they're going to be on the sea, yes?
Yeah.
And furthermore, what else did we learn about these?
One's American-made and one's made by, like, God.
American-made...
American wood,
one's made. American wood, right? And then the other one?
Not human hands.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else? Was there another one somewhere?
I have a question about the hearses or whatever. They'd be like the coffin Quakeway was talking about, the canoes or whatever. He said it's made out of wood. Maybe can you see those?
Okay. Yeah, I mean, at this point, you probably want to start doing what Cedric's doing, which is like, well, what does this mean? Now, why are you doing that? Because what is one basic adjective for all these prophecies?
Obscure.
They're obscure, right? Wouldn't you agree? Like, it's hard to know what they mean, right?
Could the one...
Hold on. Before you even say another word, I want to remind you, what does Ahab conclude?
He will be hung.
No, at the end, he says... What does he say? At the end, he says, I'm immortal by land and sea. Do you remember this? Now, I want to explain something to you which you may not have understood. Captains cannot be hanged on their own ships. Right? Because they're in charge. They would have to be tried by other captains. It's called a court-martial, right? So what would this mean if you're going to get hanged and you're a captain? It's got to... Yeah, very good, Mikey. Say that again. It's got to be on the land, because you have to have other captains around to try you, okay, right? So he's immortal on sea if he has to get hanged on shore, but what does he also have to do?
See
these things on the sea. So he's like, oh, cool, I can't be killed on land and I can't be killed on the sea, I'm immortal. But it says, how does he respond? What does it say? He laughs. Can you guys find it? What does it say? He says, I'm immortal by land and sea. With a laugh of derision. What does that mean?
He doesn't believe it.
Yeah, it may imply that, like, he doesn't buy any of this stuff, right? It's just nonsense to him.
Wait, why can't he be killed on the sea?
Because he has to be hanged on shore. Because he's a captain. You can't be hanged on your own ship.
Oh, right. What if the crew mutinies?
Well, usually when you mutiny, what do you do with the guy?
Sorry,
you throw him overboard. That's usually the protocol, right? Like, chuck him overboard. So go, Kim.
So do the little whaling boats that they launch count as on the boat? Like, can he die on that?
Well, it's not about boats. boats or not boats. It's about the sea or the land. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but you can't be hung on the ship, or can you be hung on, like...
No, because if I... It's like trying to hang a guy in a canoe. Like, could you... You know, like this. There's no way to do that, right? You try to hang him, you go flop over into the water. They're not that big. Yeah, go ahead.
So, going by hemp, could that be a connection to the line?
I don't know. We know that the line is made of manila sometimes and hemp other times. So, look, I'm just going to stop you right here because I want you to do this on your own. I want you to start thinking, like, And I think you have enough clues to think, like, some of the possibilities here. But what I really want you to do is this, is to think about Macbeth for a minute, okay? So let's do a little CF Macbeth. Okay, can you guys remember what are the two prophecies about Macbeth that he heard but he didn't quite understand, but he had his own theories? Go ahead. Thane of Cawdor. And that actually happened before he even knew it, right? They sent it to him, and then he comes somewhere else and like, hail, Thane of Cawdor. So he's like, ooh, these prophecies come true, right? And actually, what prophecy came true for Ahab? Do you guys remember? Elijah told us this. He's like, hey, did they tell you about this guy? Did they tell you how he lost his leg according to the prophecy? So apparently this interchange or this interaction with Moby Dick had been already foretold, and that he was going to lose his leg. Now hold on a second though. What else happens to Macbeth? What other prophecies? Do you guys remember this? Yes, Jason?
Is it like Forrest moves to the castle and then...
Very good, right? He says, I don't know, it says something like, you will fall, I don't remember how it goes exactly, when Burnham Woods comes to Elsinore.
Yeah.
You guys remember that?
Yeah.
Now... That seems very strange, doesn't it? And do you guys remember how Macbeth interprets that? What does that mean?
Trees are going to make a move to the city.
Yeah, but when will that happen?
Never.
Never, right? He understands, like, that's like me saying, like, yeah, you can make the pro team when you snowballs have a chance of not melting in hell. Like, what does that mean?
When hell freezes over.
Like never. It's never going to happen, right? So that's how Macbeth reads that prophecy, but what does it turn out does happen?
The army disguises
themselves. What?
They disguise themselves as bushes and stuff.
Okay, and they creep up with bushes and branches in front of them, so Burnham Woods comes to them, yes? What's the other one?
Can't be killed by somebody who's a male, something like that.
I'm quite right. You're on the right track. You cannot be killed by...
Born with natural...
No man of... Of woman born. You guys remember this?
Oh, yeah.
No man of woman born can kill thee, Macbeth. And he's like, sweet, what does that mean?
Everybody's born a woman.
Everybody's born a woman, so no one, I will not be killed by a person, right? And then we learn what happened. That, who killed him?
Duh.
I'm going to bring this... Beckford in here in about a minute. Wait, who killed...
Macduff!
Thank you!
Oh, I
finally!
Oh, Brad's
finally!
Brad's
thank you, Brad. Good work. Now, if you remember, he said... Do you remember what happened to him? He was... What's that great line? He was un... Hello. He was untimely ripped from his mother's womb.
Yeah.
Right? What does that mean? It's a C-section, right? So he wasn't born of woman in the traditional sense, right? So, turns out, how do these prophecies work?
They
Mikey, speak.
There's like a fine print to them.
there's loopholes.
Yeah.
It, at first, it seems like you can't be killed by anything, but like there's going to be some loophole at some point. Like they might be able to try him on the ship in some fashion.
Okay. Yeah. There's. I guess the thing I hope you guys see is that the conclusions people draw from these are oftentimes erroneous. They mislead themselves. Right. Do you guys remember? What the prophecy was for old Oedipus?
That
he was going to
kill his father
and marry
his mother. Remember this? And he's horrified at this. So you know what he does? He flees his mother and father. But it turns out that's not really his mother and father. They were his adopted parents. He didn't know it. And he tries to escape his fate, right? So... You need to be thinking about these guys in the background and keep your eyes peeled for these prophecies as we move forward. Capiche?
Mm-hmm.
All right, now, let's do 118. So, look, I... And and Mr. Macaluso is going to roll, and Mr. Conroy are going to roll over in their future graves if you can't answer this question properly. And then you also know what he means by the level compass, and you also need to know what he means by the log and the line. It's a chapter I should call The Log and the Line, which will be clear to you after we talk about this. What do these things all have in common?
Just measuring
navigation.
What's that?
They have to do with navigation.
They have to do with navigation. Very good. What does this thing measure?
Latitude.
Yeah, it helps. It doesn't actually measure latitude. It measures the angle of the sun. But that you can derive your latitude from that, right? Hello? What do we learn in history about this from the 17th century? Nah, you can say it.
What?
Come on, you guys. I know that Mr. Macaluso said, oh, there were several innovations from this period that allowed people to explore the world, one of which was the caravel. What was the other one? The astrolabe, which essentially is the same kind of tool, right? It allows you to measure the angular distance of the sun from the horizon, which helps you figure out where you are in the planet. You with me? All right, and then finally, this one you may not, you guys all know what a compass is, right?
Yeah.
Now, you know why he calls the, this is important in a minute. He calls it the level compass because of the following. Ready for this? Pay attention. In a ship this size, there would be something called the binnacle. And the binnacle would be in front of the guy who's driving the ship, all right? And what it is basically a housing, yes, with a big piece of glass so you can look in. You with me so far? Two magnets on the side. What are the magnets for? Is to kind of cancel out any strange magnetic anomalies that might be in the area or on the ship. Hello, you follow me? And then inside would be a sealed bubble, which would have oil in it, and then a card that was magnetized. And so why would it have to be on oil? Think for a minute.
So it could make it rotate?
No. Well, partly, yes. So it could rotate this way. But where are we?
On water.
So what's that mean? This boat is usually, this ship is going like this all the time. Right? So it's able to always be level because it's on its own little planet, if you will, right? It's its own little
plane
because of the fluid it's floating in, right? So it's always level with the Earth's, surface. Does that make sense?
So it's not always level with the
surface. Yeah, it's not usually, like if the deck is heaving like this, it's not going to be parallel to that. It's always going to be, at right angles to a line going to the radius of the Earth. You follow me? Always. So that's why he calls it the level compass, because the compass will always be level. Peach? Now, let me explain to you what the log and the line are, because, again, it's going to be important for this. So, this measures, does anybody know what this measures? Say, I don't know, or I know.
I don't know.
Think guess?
A log? I mean, long distance?
Maya, you look like you're thinking over there. Okay, it measures velocity. It's a very simple tool. Ready for this? This is awesome. On every ship back in those days, can I borrow this for a minute? Thank you.
Like
that. Yeah. Full sand, what's this called?
Hourglass,
right? And it has a certain, it's calibrated so a certain amount, like a minute, we'll say, I don't remember how it is. A minute will go by when you do this, right? It's actually not that much, but let's say half a minute. And then you have this board, which is called the log, and it's attached to a line. And what you do is you throw it overboard, and there are knots at regular intervals. So, Brad's my little underling. I say, throw it, and I turn this at the same moment, and then we count the number of knots that go overboard. You with me? So what do we have? Distance, time, speed, right? You with me? Distance, that's your knots. Time, that's this thing. So we have velocity. You following this? And that's why, you guys know this, don't you? You measure the speed of vessels, like planes and in knots. Hello, yes, you with me? So, again, this is something that happens on a level plane, right? It's on the surface of the ocean. Capiche? So, here's my question for you guys. What makes Ahab so furious about this quadrant? Come on, like he gets, strangely angry He's doing something he's probably done 1,000 times before. Why does he suddenly get infuriated? Go ahead, Nick, you speak.
Isn't he trying to, like, locate where Moby Dick is?
Well, not with a quadrant. Quadrant's just for, you know, catching the sun's angular distance. So, you're on the right track, though. Come on. What is it, Maya?
Is he, like, trying to compare, like, where he would be, but he doesn't know, like, where he actually is?
You're getting there. You're getting better. Look, in order to use a quadrant, what do you have to be looking at?
The sun.
The sun, right? And what does he say the sun knows?
Where Moby Dick
is, right? Because the sun is looking down on the earth. Mm-hmm. So, check it out. He's looking at the sun.
Oh, is this like another whale
Speak
head?
Up.
This is another version of the whale head, or the, was it the, what we talked about yesterday? Was
yes.
Tattoo system?
Yeah.
So, this is just him trying to find the inscrutable thing.
And what is the, think about this, what is the quadrant reminding him of in this moment that makes him so furious? You speak, Isaiah.
Then he doesn't know exactly where Moby Dick is.
Yeah, so more generally, though, what's he furious about? Maybe it's about not knowing Moby Dick, but what else does he
know? He doesn't know anything.
Yeah, he doesn't, there's so much that's inscrutable, right? And if you read carefully, hey, do me a favor. See if you can find the first place the quadrant is mentioned and notice its description. This is kind of interesting, and it does just what Rachel was doing, which is comparing it with the tattoo, with the painting, with the whale's head.
Painting?
At the Spouter Inn.
How does that have to do with anything?
It's this whole, well, it's this idea of like looking at something, trying to figure out what it means. It's sublime. What does it say it has on it?
It says colored glasses.
Yeah, more.
Colored glasses through which to take the sun.
Yes, but it's about markings.
Oh, that's all.
Cabalistic. What does it say?
Cabalistical contrivances.
Cabalistical. Do you guys know that word?
I don't know that word.
Okay.
Kind of holy.
Speak up.
It's a Judeo holy.
Oh yeah, man, Luke. Slow down, Luke. Everyone, listen to Luke now. He's got the right answer. Say it.
It's a Judeo like holy code, like to how to reach the enlightenment. I mean, kind of enlightenment, and like how the heaven and earth works.
So this is like.
Yeah, let me just say one more about this because it's kind of cool. So listen carefully. Kabbalah is this study of Hebrew scripture, which is always looking for some like mystery. Because, I don't know if you guys know this, the Hebrew alphabet is like the Roman alphabet in that it has numbers assigned to the letters. You ever know about Roman numerals? So it's true also for the Hebrew alphabet. So there's this whole sort of science about trying to find hidden meaning in scriptural text by looking at the number value of words. You with me? So look. What's he basically pointing out? What's another word for Kabbalistic, but it's in Egypt?
Hieroglyphic,
right? There's all these weird markings on this thing. And what is Ahab reminded of? By the quadrant.
What he doesn't know.
And the tattoos, and the whale's head, and the coin.
Where is this?
I can't find it.
It's
on the bottom of page 4.
It's at the top of the paragraph on the bottom.
Okay, 443, he's Kabbalistic. So as we say, all that he doesn't know, all that's hidden from him, right? What did he say yesterday when he's looking at the tattoos? Come on, I want a quote from you. What does he say? Fist clenched. What? Oh, devilish. Wait, you don't recall? We went through this whole little mythological story yesterday. He's looking at old Queequeg's tattoos.
Oh, is it with the
devilish tantalization of the gods? Remember this? Mm-hmm. It's right there in front of him, but he doesn't know what it means. Okay, now, let me ask you something right now. He says, no more will I look up into the heavens, right? No more. I'm going to keep my eyes here. You with me? Keep my eyes where they ought to be, on a level. And so therefore he says, I'm going to navigate from now on with a compass and the log and the line. Now, let's do a little... Cedric, you seem like you know a little about navigation. Let's say you are on the ocean. This is a map of the ocean. Okay? You with me? Can you figure out... And let's say you start here. Can you figure out where you will be tomorrow if you know your velocity and you know your direction? is north, right? So let's say I said, oh, I'm traveling north by east for 24 hours at 12 knots. Should I be able to figure out where I am on the morrow?
Yeah. If you know how far away the other point is.
No, no, no. Let's do this. When you multiply velocity, which is what? Distance over time, times what? Time, right? What can you get? Distance. So that means you will know how long this line is. And then what's the only other thing you need to know? It's direction. So that should be able to tell you where you are. Are you following this? This is what they call dead reckoning. But there's a lot of other things to take into account. Like, for instance, what happens on the water that doesn't happen on a road?
Waves.
Yeah, waves, current,
wind.
What did we? What was that word we learned in chapter 23? What wind gives you?
Leeway,
right? So good. Would then add a little bit of, or take a little bit away because of leeway and currents and whatnot. All right, we got five.
Woo!
We didn't really get too far into 119, which is sad, but tomorrow is another day.